The kinds of experiences that people have in these high-dose psychedelic trials are usually unprecedented in their lives. These drugs are not a walk in the park. They are powerful substances that occasion powerful experiences.
I think it's really important to have specialist trained therapists working with psychedelics because it is quite a unique field. When you're working with people that have really profound mental health symptoms, safety is just paramount.
The clinical trials that have been done overseas have attracted a huge amount of scientific, medical, and community interest. There is still a huge amount of work to do before we can start advocating for these agents to be used more generally in the community as treatments for disorders such as major depression.
We know quite a bit with quite a high confidence about how these compounds work in the brain at the molecular level. What we actually don't know much, and that's what we are trying to do in our lab and in our experiments, is to understand how they work at the level of brain regions and brain networks.
I'm the head of clinical psychedelic research at Monash. I'm initially leading two groundbreaking trials. The first one is psilocybin-assisted psychotherapy in the treatment of generalized anxiety disorder. Psilocybin is the active ingredient in magic mushrooms.
This will be a world-first study. No one's looked at psilocybin in generalized anxiety disorder before. This is a major debilitating psychiatric illness for which we have really relatively ineffective treatments for a large proportion of the population.
The psilocybin trial at Monash is by far the largest trial in Australia, and indeed it is among the large trials in the modern era globally. We're also testing MDMA-assisted psychotherapy in the treatment of post-traumatic stress disorder. MDMA is commonly known as ecstasy. This trial is in partnership with our colleagues, the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies in the United States. And MAPS is an organization that is leading the charge globally with respect to MDMA treatment. Another motivation for this trial is that we have recruited a large group of experienced and qualified mental health care workers, from psychiatrists through to psychologists and psychotherapists. And this group of professionals has received training from MAPS in the United States, and indeed they will receive clinical supervision from MAPS through the duration of the trial. After that process, they can be accredited by MAPS. This is significant because MAPS is set to be the first organization in the world to take a psychedelic drug to market.
For us then to undertake clinical trials at Monash using these agents, we have an extraordinarily rigorous and robust process through which we select patients and then we screen and screen again and screen again before people can be enrolled.
Creating the right conditions for somebody to have a psychedelic experience can really impact the journey that somebody goes on in a dosing session.
When someone takes one of these substances, they move into a state that can be initially quite anxiety provoking. In that space, a sense of safety is profoundly important. We have two therapists working with a participant, people who have spent, firstly, a long time training to be able to do this, but secondly, a long time with this particular participant, getting to know them, getting to know their particular anxieties, building a deep sense of trust and safety with that person.
We had very rigorous protocols around safety. I'm leading a trial in which healthy participants will be given psilocybin. There will be two facilitators who are experienced and who have been trained they will be supporting the participant through their experiment. Once the psilocybin is ingested, after 60 minutes, they will be having a peak experience, psychedelic experience. At that point, they will be moved to an MRI scanner. This will allow us to look into the brain in real time. After the MRI session, they will be moved into a EEG room. EEG is, again, looking into the brain, but at faster time scales.
Both of those enable us to essentially to study the networks of brain connectivity. And so we'll be looking at the effects of psilocybin. We'll be scanning people's brains before and then during the psilocybin experience. This is a groundbreaking trial because it is now applying the administration of psilocybin to healthy volunteers and correlating the psychological effects with the neurological effects.
There has been evidence that the context and the mindset, they help with better psychedelic experience, which results in better therapeutic outcomes. And this is why we are combining brain imaging with meditation and music.
The aim of this study really is a form of preventative medicine to establish whether the administration of a psychedelic such as psilocybin might assist people to avoid some of the negative mental health conditions that appear to develop just in the course of life. We would generally be looking at trying to avoid depression, anxiety, some of the rigid sort of patterns of thought that might contribute to obsessive compulsive disorder, eating disorders, and so on and so forth. I'm really hoping that through this trial, we will be able to make an Australian contribution to the global research effort, as well as improving the quality of life of Australians. We feel that the collective state of mind may benefit dramatically from our research and its careful application in the future.
We're attempting to help our patients to have greater access to the sources of their distress and then to work with them and to process them in healthier ways and to understand themselves better. What's happening is that a person is getting in touch with their behavior, with their memories, in a way that they haven't been in touch with that before or for a very long time. They've avoided it in order to survive. After just a few hours of these kinds of profound experiences of contact, people experience lasting changes in their lives.
People talk about that they felt their inside is in sync with the outside world. Not everyone will have those positive experiences. For some people, there could be more confronting experience. However, the evidence is this, that it doesn't matter. The health outcomes are largely similar.
It seems that a lot of people in our society are feeling more and more alienated. They feel less and less in control of their lives. They feel more isolated. And so there seems to be the potential for psychedelic-assisted therapies to re-establish some of the connectedness among people within society. There's still a lot of people who remain unconvinced, and it has to be said that there are skeptics of psychedelic-assisted therapies and their efficacy. On the other hand, of course, there are plenty of mental health practitioners and professionals who are very interested in exploring the potential, primarily because they are frustrated by the inadequacy of the approaches that we've been using to date.
Psychiatric disorders have inadequate substandard treatments currently. People suffer under the burden of the illness from inadequate response to current treatments, from high side effect burdens of current treatments.
One of the big differentiators is that really a treatment regimen with a psychedelic medicine, you may only require two or three doses in a clinically controlled setting, and the beneficial effects, they can last for months and even years. If you contrast that with how we're currently treating mental health issues from a therapeutic context, you might be prescribed an antidepressant, and then you might be on that drug for many months, years, indeed for the rest of your life.
We're still trying to understand clearly what the safety and efficacy profiles are and who it works for and how to do it well. But it does look very promising, and MDMA for PTSD looks very likely to become a legal treatment in the US and other jurisdictions, including Australia, in 2023. And psilocybin-assisted therapies for depression look like they're perhaps 3 or so years behind that.
I think with that, we need to be careful not to dress this up as a miracle cure or something that is going to work for everybody. My hope is that people can experience this treatment and go on to lead really healthy lives and not have to be in the throes of a chronic mental illness.
If we were able to have new treatments that modified the course of the disease, which worked more quickly, which had longer durations of effect, which had less in the way of side effects, this would be truly transformative. This would not be transformative just at a local level or a national level. This would be an internationally important set of discoveries which could potentially help tens of millions of people around the world.